Emily Bodie, and thank you for joining me today to find out more about Victoria University's options in dermal science and speech pathology. Joining me in the hot seat to answer all of our questions, we have Debbie James, one of our associate professors in speech pathology. Welcome, Debbie.
Thank you and hello.
We have Claire Simpson, who is one of our lecturers in dermal science. Hello, Claire.
Hi, Emily.
And we have Celia Soares, one of our speech pathology students. Welcome, Celia.
Hi.
So, Claire, I might start with you. When we talk about careers in dermal science, what opportunities are there for students?
There's actually quite a lot of opportunities. It's a new and emerging profession. It's an area of a lot of interest. So the main areas that our graduates would go and work in is plastic surgery and cosmetic physicians' practices, where they offer a lot of the dermal therapies procedures like laser and light-based therapies, skin peeling, skin health checks, those sort of things. We also have quite a lot of our graduates work in medical aesthetic companies. So the companies that supply the laser machines, for example, will employ our graduates as trainers in that area too. And because we're independent practitioners, they can also go and open their own practices. So there's quite a lot of different and diverse opportunities for a dermal clinician to go out and work.
So Australia has an ageing population. How does that play into careers in dermal science?
Absolutely. People are concerned with the health of their skin at all ages. So there's various different concerns that people will come to a dermal clinician about. But as an ageing population, obviously there are the so-called anti-ageing procedures that people are quite interested in. I'm not so keen on the title anti-ageing. I don't think we're completely anti-ageing. However, there is quite a lot we can do to help improve skin integrity. And in Australia, one of the biggest factors on our skin is actually our environment, our sun. And as we get older, there is an accumulation effect of that. And therefore, looking after your skin and certain procedures that we do as dermal clinicians can treat things like sun damage, photo damage, and various different disorders associated with that, for example. So yeah, it's a big opportunity for us.
A lot of those dermal sciences tie very closely in with the beauty therapy industry, and we do have a pathway available into the Bachelor of Dermal Science through our Diploma of Beauty Therapy. Tell us a little bit about that process and what credits students might be eligible for if they've studied previously.
Sure, you're quite right. The two courses are very closely linked to each other, and what we have is that pathway for the Diploma of Beauty Therapy students. So if someone does do a Diploma of Beauty Therapy, they can get 96 credit points, which is for the whole of first year, and they enter into the degree at second year, so they just need to do the final 3 years of the degree. If they're a VU student, that's an automatic offer made to them on successful completion of their diploma.
A really good opportunity, and an opportunity for people to enter the workforce as well once they complete that diploma before continuing on with the
Absolutely.
Bachelor as well.
And it gives them two qualifications, so that's a wonderful thing. It gives them a much broader area that they can work in. And we love having beauty therapists in the course as well, because they have those fantastic hands-on skills already and they're used to dealing with clients. And that's a really great thing to bring into a more medical-based degree course. Mm.
So some good opportunities for students entering into the Bachelor through the diploma. Do they need to have a diploma before they can enter Bachelor of Dermal Science?
Not necessarily. We do have a first year of our degree as well. So if someone's a school leaver, for example, or they're wanting a bit of a career change, we do have a lot of nurses also come into the degree. There is a first year that you can do as well. So you don't necessarily have to come from that beauty therapy background, but there's the opportunity for both types of people.
Great, a variety of opportunities available to students.
Absolutely.
So Debbie, speech pathology is a really exciting and innovative field. Tell us a little bit about the opportunities that our students will encounter in the workforce.
Oh, there's lots of opportunities, Emily. So, and they're growing and growing, and they're growing for lots of reasons. But students can work with, well, they're not students anymore, they're graduates. They can work within the education department, so work in schools. So there's a lot of work in that area that they can work in. They work in hospitals, so they might work with people, younger people or older people, so children right across the age span. A lot of people work in neonatal intensive care units, so right from that very young age through to people being in palliative care. So right across that spectrum, they work in rehabilitation centres. So there's lots of openings in the education and the medical areas, but there's new openings happening more and more with community services. So people are working more and more with the youth justice system. And there are people working with people in jails. And another big area is with people who work with voice. So people who are actors or other professional voice users, so teachers or auctioneers, speech pathologists work with those people as well. So right across the spectrum in a number of different areas.
Yeah, very interesting. You've called out a couple of those industries where speech pathologists are required. Certainly some things that I hadn't considered when I was thinking about what speech pathology is or who it would help. And I understand that it's a real area of concern or a real growing area, particularly in the west of Melbourne, where we have so many of our campuses and so many of our community members studying with us. Tell us a bit about why it's so important to the west.
It's important to the West for a range of reasons. As Claire was saying before, with our ageing population, people, as they get older, are more likely to have problems with their speaking or their communication or another area is their swallowing. I didn't mention that before. So speech pathologists also work with people that have got swallowing problems. Because we've got an ageing population out in the West, that's one area, but it's also a huge growing population, so there's lots of children in that area too. And then we get the overlay with people who come from different cultural and linguistic backgrounds as well. So the West of Melbourne is very rich in that area, so there are opportunities to be working with those communities too. So there are a number of people that will have communication problems that are not necessarily because they've had a sort of a known problem. So sometimes people will have communication difficulties because they've come from a different linguistic background or a different cultural background. And so speech pathologists can help working with those communities. So not just working with the individual person, him or herself, but also working with their communities. And it's probably worthwhile reflecting on the point. If we think about someone who's, say, had an accident, so they could have been in a car accident, they could have had a medical emergency like a stroke or something like that, and they land up in hospital. And one of the things that might happen to them is that their communication is affected because of that injury. And so we also work with the family in that situation to work with that person so everyone can communicate with one another. So working with families and community members is also a very important big part of our work and a growing area.
Celia, you're studying speech pathology with Victoria University. Tell us a bit about what you think makes a good speech pathologist.
Just as Debbie mentioned, with speech pathology, you're quite autonomous in your role. However, when you're working with a client, it is quite holistic. So having a genuine interest in helping people and compassion and being sensitive to a client's needs will go a long way with speech pathology, but also being creative, adapting to evolving methods and ways that we can work with clients. Everything else just comes with your learning. So science and all of that, as a student, I was a little bit apprehensive about that, but that all comes with the degree. But if you can have those two skills, being compassionate and sensitive to your clients, I think that's a good start.
How do you think VUs help set you up to enter the industry?
I'm a big fan of the block model I've tried the traditional university timetable, but the block model allows me to work on a unit on a 4-week basis. So I can focus on that unit, I can put all my time into that unit, and then finished, we can move on to the next one. So I think, and with COVID, I think they've done really well to adapt, make our students adapt to this new way of learning. So we've had to, learn really quickly as with everybody else. So I think they've facilitated that really well.
When it comes to looking forward and graduating, what kind of industry or what part of the industry are you hoping to go into, do you think?
Again, as Debbie mentioned, youth justice is a big area for me. I have an interest with youth work. And I thought, okay, how can I combine science and youth speech pathology? So I hope by the end of my degree, I'm able to pursue that area.
Brilliant. Well, we certainly wish you the best of luck.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for answering a couple of my quick questions, but we did have a number of questions submitted ahead of time from prospective students looking to study in these courses at Victoria University. So I might cross to some of their questions. The first one, Claire, for you, I live interstate. Can I still study the dermal sciences degree? Question we get all the time.
Yes, we do get that. It's a very popular question for our course because our course is quite unique. That is quite a common question that we get. And from second year onwards, in our degree, we do have an option for a blended delivery. And that means that students do a lot of their theory online. So it's been quite good for this year talking about COVID-19 and having to be flexible in that environment. We did have online offerings already, which was a great advantage for us. So students can study remotely in that way, but they do come on campus in Melbourne. We've got a fantastic clinical space where the students come into our teaching clinic to learn the hands-on skills, but they'll do that in little bursts of time, so 1 week block every so often to learn those skills towards the latter part of the degree. So yes, they can certainly study online from second year of the degree. So generally speaking, they need to come from a beauty therapy background to utilise that, because that gives them the credit then for the first year, which isn't online.
And I imagine a lot of people looking at those online study options, if they're living in interstate or working in the industry, because the Bachelor of Dermal Science is actually very unique to Victoria University.
It is incredibly unique. We were the first English-speaking university to offer a degree like this, and we've really led the way in that. We've been the ones that have essentially created a new profession for this actual sort of emerging need that was there. So yeah, it's been exciting to be involved with that.
Well, you talk about industry leading courses, but if we're able to conceptualise a course that's ahead of the industry, that's a big feather in the cap.
Absolutely, yeah, something we're very proud of.
So Debbie, when you were speaking about opportunities in speech pathology, you spoke about a number of areas like health science and youth justice. Are there any particular qualifications or prerequisites for the speech pathology courses here that students would need to have a background or a knowledge in?
We describe the course or speech pathology as a fusion of health sciences and social sciences. So students can come in from any of those backgrounds. So if they've got, you know, if they've come from a strong background, say if they're a school leaver and they've done more social sciences, yep, so long as they meet the ATAR requirements and those sorts of things, they're able to come in, just as the students that come from a science background. So the big thing students need to be aware of is if you've come from sort of one of those sides, you will need to be learning about the other sides. But if you've got a passion about combining those sorts of things, as we hear Celia saying, then speech pathology can offer that fusion.
Yeah, wonderful. And we always recommend that for students looking for entry requirements or criteria, definitely to check the VU website. Always has the most up-to-date information, depending on a student's circumstances as well. So we have a question here. I might direct this to both you and Claire, Debbie. So the question is around placements, and something that's probably so important for these client-facing services that we're dealing with. So Claire, I might start with you. What kind of placement opportunities can we find in our dermal sciences courses?
So we have about 350 hours, or in excess of 350 hours, that the students actually do within our practical and clinical settings. As I mentioned, we've got a state-of-the-art teaching clinic, and that's in our city campuses. And that's equipped with a huge range of equipment, devices, and opportunity to actually practice a lot of those procedures. And the idea of that is, over the final couple of years of the degree, we're building that skills and knowledge in unison. We're starting off with sort of entry level, sort of basic understanding and basic skills, but then we're building gradually until we get to a very proficient level at performing those procedures and offering those services that we do, so that our students are as industry ready as possible. Because it is an emerging profession, they will often go into a workplace where they may be the only dermal clinician there. So they do have to be as industry ready as possible and able to really commence practice straight away.
And Debbie, your thoughts?
Well, our students have lots of opportunities for clinical practice. So they start in first year with a placement as part of one of their units. That happens in secondary. So our course goes over 4.5 years. So they're more general ones to introduce them to people that will have communication problems, but also learning more general things. And then as they get further on in the course, then they become more specialised and will go out to placements, say, like I was mentioning before. So they'll go to hospitals, they'll go to schools. We hope we can get places in youth justice centres and those sorts of things for them as well. So, but the last year of the course is where the major area is for the clinical placement. So both semesters, the students will have two big placements over that time. And unlike Claire was saying, we don't count the hours per se. Students need to prove that they meet the competencies that the professional association has laid down. But that happens gradually. So they'll have lots of opportunities over the 4.5 years to do clinical placements, but they'll get more and more, they'll have more of it towards the end of the course.
So Celia, you're a relatively new student in speech pathology. Are you looking forward to these kind of placements that are coming further down the track that Debbie was speaking about?
Oh, I'm excited. I'm excited to consolidate all my learning into practice in the years to come.
Mm. And why do you think it's important that we offer such a range of opportunities when it comes to placements?
Well, I think it's important to put all our knowledge that we're learning in the classrooms into practice. And, you know, speech pathology is a field where there's lifelong learning. So I think what we can utilise in the classroom out in the field is only going to support our professional development.
Wonderful. Well, that's just about all we have time for today. Thank you so much to Celia, to Claire and to Debbie for answering my questions and the questions of our prospective students as well. Thank you all so much for sharing your expertise and your experiences with us. It's been really valuable for me to find out a little bit more about what's on offer here and the student experience behind the courses as well. So we hope you've enjoyed hearing a little bit more about the options in speech pathology and dermal science at Victoria University. Be sure to visit these areas of the Open Day site, add them to your block to get more information. We wish you the best of luck with your future studies at VU.